Ramanathan Failingham and Satoshi Tsutsimoto are here today to inform us. Ram is the senior CMI manager at Unilever, based in Singapore, and his passion is in finding new ways to unearth insights. Dr. Satoshi Tsutsimoto is the director of neuroscience with Nielsen Consumer Neuroscience, also based in Singapore. His research interest is in understanding the neural mechanisms of higher order cognitive functions, such as fluid reasoning and abstract thinking. A warm applause for Ramanathan Failingham and Satoshi Tsutsimoto.
Good morning. It's so impressive that they try to pronounce my strange name and his great name from India. It's very great to be here. So as introduced already, we'd like to talk about a case study that has applied neuroscience to the promotions in Thailand market. So it's a kind of co-presentation from two of us. So I'd like to start with a bit about ourselves and our positioning in this study. So I spent 15 years in basic and applied neuroscience field. And then 6 years ago, I joined Nielsen, where I've been involved in many, many consumer neuroscience studies across Asia Pacific region. And currently I'm based here in Singapore. So I joined this project from agency side. That's my position.
Good morning, everybody. I didn't pronounce my long name, but so my name is Ram, and I'm with the Consumer and Market Insights team at Unilever. Gemma alluded a little bit to the market research spends in the region, and I think Unilever accounts for a sizable chunk of that. I've been at Unilever for the last 9 years, and a few years before that with Nielsen. I think as an insights professional, the last couple of years, I've been super interesting with the development in technology that allows us to measure implicitly. I think a lot of the technology that you see outside allows us to really get deeper to understand consumer decision making. That for us as clients is really interesting. And that's also the reason why I'm here, to share with you, along with Satoshi-san, a pilot that we've done to try and understand the brain responses to promotional mechanics and how to drive conversion in store.
Thanks, Ram. Could you tell us some background of this study?
Thank you. So I think just a brief background. So I think the whole behavioral sciences space and behavioral economics has kind of really come into the limelight. And we've got two Nobel Prize winners for economics from the field, Daniel Kahneman in 2002. More recently, we had Richard Thaler for his application of nudge in 2017. And a lot of these studies that started in academia and in the laboratory have actually come into real-life applications. I think a lot of them still remain very much in the space of government policy, and they're talking about addiction control, etc. So a lot of it's still in the space of government policy, getting people to sign up for organ donation, a responsible consumption of utilities, and so on. And the applications, when it comes to actual consumer packaged goods, understanding consumers and shoppers and how they make decisions, and actually influence that decision process by brands, is just getting started. And I think that the future is going to be really exciting if we're able to take a lot of those implicit learnings forward. If you take some of the real life examples, and this is on the Netflix page in Singapore in terms of the subscription packages that they offer. If you look at the way the offers are presented, you can see that they are almost alluding to a default option, which is the premium option. The basic and the standard options are kind of grayed up. Now, you can choose the standard or the basic options, but it means that you've got to make a conscious choice to move away from what they're presenting as a default. And I would still wager that even if that's the case, a lot more people are signing up for the standard package, because the premium package, in relation to that, the standard package is seen to be more value. So the premium package acts like a decoy almost, or a reference set for people to use, and then they move into the standard package. If the premium package is not there, a lot more people will be buying into the basic package. So ways in which brands and companies are starting to move people towards where they want them to go. This is also very relevant, I think, in the whole retail space. And this is a space where you know, as shoppers, we kind of inundated with a whole bunch of messaging when we enter the store. A lot of it competing for attention, and the decisions we are making at a very implicit level is in that context, just in that context of reference, you know, contrasting with the kind of conflicting messages and so on. I think behavioral sciences, for a long time, has been applied in this space to kind of drive consumer and shopper behavior. So the very first time somebody did a buy one, get one free, you know, a bulk off offer, you know, just a way to drive increased consumption by offering value to consumers. But then, as a consumer packaged goods company, we also realized that we spend a lot more marketing budget in below the line activities than above the line. Brand recall, etc. But below the line is all about the battle for conversion. So you get people to convert when they're at the shelf. But then when the retail environment is as cluttered as you see here, how do you get your brand messages to stand out? How do you call out attention to yourself in that clutter? And I think that's again where a lot of the behavioral science applications have started to come to play. So if you look at this one, there's a very clear play on the loss aversion lever, you know, or as millennials would call it, you know, it's the whole FOMO behavior, where they kind of put a time constraint to the promotion and they say it's only valid for Black Friday, buy now or regret forever times. And kind of, it's a lot more effective in getting people to implicitly feel an angst and therefore you kind of buy into the promotion. So a lot of these things are already starting to come to play. So the project that we would talk to you about was a big promotional campaign that we wanted to do in Thailand. It was one of the biggest activities for the brand in that market for the year. And we could have approached it in a few ways. You know, we could have gone by the traditional ways of we've always been doing promotions, we measure the promotions after we see sales uplift, share gain, etc. We could have always done the same thing and then measured the post impact. What we wanted to do in this case was to say, is there a way for us to test the effectiveness of different promo mechanics up front and almost design the promo message and the promo visuals and the promo callouts and so on in a way that improves their effectiveness at an implicit level? And that's the study we'll take you through.
Okay, yeah, let's move on to the stimuli and methods. So this is an example of the key visuals we have tested in this study. It's actually a mock-up based on the actual stimulus because of the confidentiality reasons. And the language is also translated from from Thailand language to English for that presentation purpose. As you can see here, it has a buy two, get one free offer as a promotion. And this is a set of key visuals we have tested in this study. It's across different categories. And also the type of promotions are quite diverse, such as the volume offer, like buy two, get one free type offer. Or the price, which is like a discount, percent price discount kind of things. And then offering the gift bag, or like a free raffle to win something good. Importantly, the values in the same promotion types is actually the same. So for example, in this case, second piece with 50% discount or second piece with half the price. The same value, different statement. And each participant looked at only one stimulus from one type, so they never compared the offers directly. They are tested in our facility and laboratory in Nielsen. So let me show you an overview of the consumer's behavior in our laboratory, which is a kind of video.
The subject checks in with reception and completes a consent form. The neurophysiologist explains the process and fits a comfortable cap on the test subject. A small quantity of gel and EEG sensors are applied to the cap. The test takes place in a viewing room. A neurophysiologist monitors the test subject from an adjacent room. The test subject performs a series of baseline tasks while the neurophysiologist monitors brain activity and eye tracking. While the actual neurological test is performed, The test subject is shown a stimuli. This can be any kind of short video or still image, such as a commercial, movie trailer, TV promo, or advertising flyer. When the test session is finished, another baseline measurement is made and the results from all test subjects are sent to another team for signal processing and analysis.
Like this way, we are using an EEG as a main tool, and we capture three key metrics using EEG: attention processing, emotional motivation, and memory activation with 10-point scales. And we combine them together into one composite measure called neurological effectiveness here. Let's look at the reason behind these metrics. Suppose these ladies entering from the door. It immediately grabs my attention probably. And also probably I sustain my attention to understand who they are or even what they are. Our attention processing score is the level of cognitive focus and cognitive effort. However, is it a good thing or a bad thing? I'm not sure, because probably I hesitate to approach them and I'm not sure if I can be a good friend with them. How about you? I don't know. Maybe you are quite open, but I'm not that open-minded. But on the other hand, these pictures immediately engage my emotion. This kind of approach avoidance reaction from the emotion center. That is the measure we capture by emotional motivation score. And in addition, if you have a little baby in your family or you are the cat lovers, these pictures are more relevant and familiar to you. The memory activation score is the level of access to the long-term memory systems, and that is related to the relevance and familiarity. For any kind of marketing materials to be effective, we believe it's not just simply attract attention, but also should engage emotion and activate memory. That is the reason behind our metrics. And we analyze it combined together with eye tracking. Based on the eye tracking data, our algorithm gives us the consumer's spontaneous groupings of the visual stimulus together with the exploration order. So the consumers look at zone one first, then zone two, and so on and so forth. And importantly, the scores below the zones that represents the effectiveness scores based on attention, emotion, and memory, while the consumers are exploring the particular zones. So it can be used for the details, diagnostics, and optimization of the key visuals. In the end, of course, we also wanted to know whether the promotions can facilitate the behavior change of consumers. Action intent based on emotion and memory. This score is designed to predict in-market performance, and that is validated in many, many studies like this way. So this is just one of the validations, and it's based on the 6 DCPG TV commercials. As you can see, the actual sales volume increment according to the marketing mix modeling, that is strongly correlated with the predicted measure based on the action intent. So the action intent is the overall measure for the likelihood of behavior change. Lastly, we are interested in the message communication to see how well the promotion communicated the key messages. We presented the sequence of key messages to the consumers before the presentation of promotional materials, and we got the reaction to each key message. That is the baseline of each participant. And we did the same exercise after the exposure to the promotional materials to see the enhancement of the reaction to each key message. By looking at the delta between pre versus post, we could test how strongly the key messages are delivered by the promotions. Okay, then let's look at the results.
So we look at the results in three buckets. The first one, we look at the visual layout, the way the promotional call out was designed and deployed. So if you look at the results, the key learning we took out was less number of visual clusters, the higher the action intent that the promotional call out kind of engineered. On this slide, you would see on the ones on the right hand side, a lot more visual clusters in terms of what people needed to process, driving down the action intent. The ones on the left, fewer visual clusters, a lot higher action intent. Anything above a score of 7 indicates a really high kind of action intent felt implicitly. In fact, the number we came up with was almost a number 4. So anything more than 4 in terms of visual clusters, and this is something that we sometimes tend to do when we try to deliver too many messages with one kind of ASIC. It kind of really pulls down the action intent. The lower the number of visual clusters actually improves the action intent when it comes to the promo callouts. It was also kind of collaborated when you kind of looked at the effectiveness of each zone, and there's a viewing sequence that people follow that you could actually engineer and get people to follow in a certain way. And the visual clusters that came in the first or the second visual zone were more effective than the ones that came much later. In fact, anything from 5 and beyond is not at all effective, and if at all, it actually pulls down the overall effectiveness as well, because it's just competing for attention and increasing the clutter in terms of the messages being delivered. In addition to the number of zones and the number of visuals that you want to maintain, I think there's also a need to maintain a certain symmetry. So you keep the text together, you kind of keep the visuals together, it just helps brain process them much easier. The example at the bottom was where the promo offer, the bag, was kind of in the middle and kind of splits the visual display. So kind of, you know, the text is then split into two parts. It's exactly the same promotion, all the three, exactly the same, buy two products, you know, get the bag for free. But then the effectiveness that you suddenly see is coming up a lot more, where there's a certain symmetry, where the text is all together and the visuals are kind of clustered together. And there's a science behind this.
Yeah, these results actually reminded me of the fact that the processing capacity inside the brain is quite limited. So for example, in terms of short-term memory, it is limited to 4 ± 1 chunks, and if it exceeds this limit, the brain overflows. That's quite simple, but I think it makes sense if we see these findings from this section, like less than 4 visual clusters, do not split attention into 2 parts. They all make sense to me from this one point of view.
The next learning that we got was in terms of the promo call-out itself. I think while as a brand we want to offer a certain promotion, there are different ways in which the same promotion in terms of what it costs us to do can be called out. And what we learned was quite interesting. So these are two promo call-outs. The first one is buy 2, get 1 free. And the second one is buy 3 for 299 Thai baht. Now for us, the cost is exactly the same in terms of delivering both of these promotions. But then you see there's a much higher action intent coming through for the buy 2, get 1 free. And it's also kind of leading back to the fact that it's much more easier for people to process. The value that they get is a lot more easily tangible versus a buy 3 for 299 requires some amount of computation and some kind of, you know, thinking that then pulls down the overall effectiveness. So simple promo callouts, you know, and I think the more tangible the value that people find, the more effective they are. This is also seen very clearly when the best performing one was the one on the far left, which is all about, it references the existing price, and it also tells you what the new price is. So it's existing, the actual price is 259. They're selling it now for a special price of 229. So there's very clear tangible 30 baht that the consumer can kind of understand. When you don't have the reference of what the current price is, the second option, which is just the same thing, but it just says special price 229, its effectiveness actually goes down significantly. Because again, there's no reference that people have in their minds in terms of what the benefit they're getting. And then you can see the effectiveness kind of going down, further down, when the same promo call-outs kind of get more complicated in terms of people needing to process more, and the value that they get is not as tangible. The other promotions that we tested were raffle offers. And these essentially are you buy a certain amount of product, you spend a certain amount of money on the brand, you get an opportunity to win a certain price. So a trip to Japan, you know, a certain number of iPhones, a certain amount of gold, and so on. I think the clear thing that we got from this one was, I think there's an iPhone win hands down. And I think there's an immediacy to that offer. I know very clearly what an iPhone is, I know what I can do with it, if I win it, it's great. So if it's 100 iPhones, 10 iPhones, it kind of works very well. Some of the other offers needed to work a little harder. And those were mainly when it came to bigger numbers. So the bigger the number that was called out, the more effective the promo was. And again, it just implicitly gets people excited to kind of look at that promotion. Bar of gold or any other kind of call out. Again, there's a science behind that.
Yeah, I think these findings are quite consistent with the behavioral economics principles. So for example, the zero price offer, that is known to be perceived as more valuable disproportionately. So buy two get one free may be considered within this framework. Also showing that the usual price together with the discount price, that can be used as a reference point, which is in line with the anchoring principles. So again, all these things quite make sense to me.
And lastly, we looked at the messaging, the actual use of words and how they kind of drive perceptions implicitly. So we looked at this promo before, so the buy two get one free versus the buy three for a certain price. So at an implicit level, the brain registers a higher value with the first one. Again, it's very clearly tangible what they're getting, the buy two get one free. It's kind of very tangible, driving very clear value perceptions for that promotion. The other interesting learning was on the use of the word discount. So there was one promo that called out the word discount, and you see that in that case, the one right in the middle, it kind of pulls down the premiumness associations to the brand. So I think in terms of, we would do promotions, we would be offering value, etc. It's always a question of what kind of words are we using, and in the long term, is it going to start diluting the perceptions that people have about the brand? So again, a very clear learning for us to kind of be careful with the way the promotions are called out. Driving not just value, but also not kind of eroding into the premium associations that the brand has. So in terms of the key takeaways.
In the end, I just want to go back to the famous system one versus system two thinking processes. I know it's not new at all, and I know almost all the marketers understand that the consumers are basically based on the system one type fast thinking processes. But nevertheless, so many in-store promotions are not grounded in this reality. It's so complicated and offering a lot of different things in one key visuals, for example. It seems like very difficult to leverage system one if we have, if we use the traditional type of research methods based on the explicit articulated response. The findings here seems like very straightforward, but we just realized after we see the results, without consumer neuroscience testing, we couldn't realize all these things. So I believe consumer neuroscience is quite useful for optimizing the promotion activities in the market. How about Ram?
I think the key learnings for me, again, I think like Satoshi was mentioning, there is a need to kind of understand before we do the promotion. And I think that was a big learning for us to say that the same promotion, there could be small tweaks that you make to the design of the visual, there could be small tweaks you make in terms of the words that you use, and you kind of implicitly drive up the effectiveness of that before you actually do it in real life. So the key learnings that I took out, and I think something that we are kind of conscious in terms of when we kind of designing new promo callouts, et cetera, going forward. And again, consumer neuroscience was a great way to kind of understand that in terms of helping the design. There's obviously a magic number four. So the number of visual clusters that you want to make sure you have. the more than four, it kind of not just are those zones ineffective, but then they pull down the overall effectiveness of the overall asset. The second key one is the navigation sequence in which you design the visual to get the messages that are decoded. Again, the first zone that is viewed is the most effective. So if there's one message you want people to take out, there's a call out, there's a promotional message that you want people to take out, it's best placed in that first visual zone. Because anything after the third or the fourth, it starts diluting in terms of how effective they are. And lastly, I think it's a choiceful use of words. I mean, it's easy for us to use words like discount, because essentially that's what we are giving people. But I think the more we use those, they start to subliminally start discounting the brand in terms of its premium use. So again, just being choiceful with the words and the call out that we use. That's what we have. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have time for one quick question.
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
A quick one.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. Very good.
Thank you.
Insightful. When you explained the start of the research, you mentioned to compare a 50% discount or 1+1 free. And in the results, you show a lower price for free and 2+1 free. That's a big difference from a market perspective. Could you tell us why the initial research differed from the results?
I think the initial one that we mentioned was part of the set. I think later on when we showed you the buy three for the price or buy two for free, the ones that kind of worked really well in terms of the effectiveness. But even the ones which was the 50% buy one get one free or the second one 50% discount was also part of the set. It is just that it's not as effective as the ones that we called out. So they were also part of the analysis set. It's just that we called out the ones that were most effective.
So the output was more or less the same, 50% versus 1+1. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Warm applause for
Thank you.